Commodore 1084S is without a doubt a brilliant monitor. Not only does it support a variety of inputs from composite, separate Lumachroma or S-video, it also has RGB, both in the form of digital RGB, so think CGA style, and it also has analog RGB. The thing that's missing from some of these monitors, in particular this one here, which is the 1084SP, is a SCART input. Now, of course, the analog RGB does have the form of a DIN input, and you can use that to inject analog RGB from, say, like a Super Nintendo here. The problem with that is that it only accepts C-Sync. Now, if you add a SCART input to this, you're still stuck with having to input C-Sync into this. And with the SCART standard, generally it's looking for composite video to use as the sync signal rather than C-Sync, which is just the sync signal by itself, whereas composite video also obviously has the video information plus that sync signal. So there are a couple of other YouTube videos on this monitor and adding SCART to it, but they don't seem to deal with the C-Sync issue. And from what I've seen, the devices that they've used to test the modification afterwards output C-Sync. Now, a couple of things to note, the instructions that I go through here to add SCART to this apply to the PAL version, and this is the stereo model. So it may be slightly different for NTSC versions and also for the mono versions of these. So to start with, we need to remove the rear cover, obviously. First things first, we just need to unhook this power cord from its little channel that it's in and remove all the screws. I've already done that. I'm sure you've removed screws before. And then we just need to disconnect the speaker connection, which is on this board back here. After that, we can put that aside. Now, of course, standard CRT safety warning. If you've never worked inside a CRT, I don't recommend starting with this video. They do contain high voltages, even when they're powered off. All right, so for the parts required, you'll obviously need a right angle SCART connector. Try and find one that has the little tabs that stick downwards alongside the pins, because there are holes in the rear of the board for those tabs. I didn't have one of those on hand, so I've got one that has these sort of wings out the side with little screw holes. That should work just fine because there is actually a metal plate here that they'll rest up against. So at least that'll provide some strain relief when I'm actually plugging something into the SCART connector. The other parts that we'll need, it's all pretty simple. A 2.2K resistor, a 39K resistor, and a 47K resistor, and just a little 2.2 microfarad 16 volt or higher capacitor. And a little jumper wire. You can always just use a leg off one of the resistors for that. Now, you could potentially do this while the board is still installed in here, but it's much easier to just pull everything out. And especially if I'm trying to film a video, I'm gonna need to pretty much pull the whole board out just so we can actually see what I'm doing. So let's discharge this thing. Listen for the click. Ooh, nice one. In fact, the camera freaked out a little bit there, obviously with that static electricity flying throughout the air. Cool, and then we just need to remove the rest of this stuff. So the power board here on the side does actually have a clip underneath. It's a bit hard to show that on camera, but you just need to push that clip in and then the power board will release. And then I just pushed it back in again. The power board will release. And if I turn this back over, all of this should slide out at least some of the way. There is a connector here which goes to the LED at the front for the power. So disconnect that and just continue pulling. We'll also have to pull off the neck board. Sometimes these may have a spot of glue there, so you'll have to cut through that glue in order to remove the neck board. And if we continue sliding, we can get to this ground wire here that goes from the CRT to the neck board, this ground wire over here, which goes down next to the flyback, and the yoke connector just here. With all that removed, all of this, oh, and the degauss coil that connects to the power board. Right, with all of those removed, we now have the board free. The power board can be disconnected here, and that's the little clip that sticks out that I was talking about. So that locks it in place over here. So let's just lock that back in for now. Now, because this is a stereo model, there's actually a little bodge wire here that goes from the right channel audio over to where the SCART connector is. So we do need to desolder this wire. Cool. We'll reconnect that in a better place later. Now, as you can probably see, I've already gone ahead and removed all the solder from where the SCART socket is and a couple of other places on the board. And the reason for that is because I already did this video before and pretty much got all the way through it and then realized that it only 50% worked because of that C-sync issue. So I decided to pull it all back out, but obviously I didn't fill in the connector holes again with solder because that's just insane. So you'll need to remove the solder from those holes and then put in our SCART connector. And with those holes free, you should be able to do this without removing this metal bracket here. You just have to jiggle it around for a little bit. And our SCART connector is now in place. Let's solder that in. You'll probably also notice that there are a few of these that don't have pads. That's perfectly fine because in this situation, they're not actually used. All we really need is the RGB lines, our sync signal, and obviously ground and the audio channels. So with the other instructions that I've seen, they simply add a jumper link to 9789. And this makes sense because that is where our sync signal actually connects up to the horizontal and vertical sync signals on these DIN connectors. The problem with that is if you run composite video into pin 20 and try and get the sync off it, the composite video signal actually seems to interfere too much and the monitor can't separate the sync from that composite video. So instead of installing a jumper at 9789, we're actually going to put in a 2.2K resistor just to lower that composite video signal a little bit. It's going to be a little bit tricky to see on camera, but the jumper link is just down here. And once again, I've already cleaned out the solder holes. All right, so our 2.2K resistor is in at jumper 9789. The RGB lines are already connected, so we don't have to worry about them. The audio left is already connected, but the audio right is this wire here, so we're going to need to reconnect that. The only other real thing on SCART is the fast blanking. Now, you don't actually have to worry about it on this monitor because it has a button for switching on and off the RGB. So in a normal SCART setup, the fast blanking signal basically blanks the composite video signal and injects RGB. And this can be done on pretty much a per pixel, although they're not really pixels, but you get what I'm saying. So they're used for like things like OSD displays and closed captioning. That's kind of the idea of the fast blanking pin. When you have a switch like this, that basically activates fast blanking for the whole display. So you just have the RGB without a composite video signal underneath. It does, however, of course, rely on still having that composite video sync. So yeah, no need to worry about the fast blanking pin on this. Even if you install the jumper, which is 9274, you'll notice that that jumper goes over to another blank space on the board. And there are a few more components that you would actually need to install. And again, it's pointless because you've got a button for RGB. So the tricky part about reconnecting the right channel audio is the right channel signal went to this hole here, which is now blocked by the SCART connector. And the only other spot is this pad here, which isn't actually a through hole. It's just a pad on this side. So what I'm going to do is run the signal wire through one of these empty holes here, just to this pad. So I'm just going to chop off this little crimp connector here. And to make this easier, I've just released this little audio board. There's just a couple of little hooks that need to be straightened out, and then you can pull this part out. So our signal wire is going to run down through one of these vacant holes, and it's just going to reach over and extend to this pad here. And then our ground wire, which I bent out of the way, this guy here, it's going to be impossible to see, but our ground wire goes back through the board and sticks out this hole here. Cool, and that's all we have to worry about with the SCART connector. So I'll just reinstall this little audio board. Right, now this is probably the trickiest part, and it took me a little while to work out because I was looking up schematics for the 1084 SP and also the 1084, which has SCART from the factory. And the schematics are laid out very differently. It looks like they were drawn by different people. So took me a little while to figure it out, but what we need to do is remove this transistor down here at TS406 and relocate it to this spot here at TS405. Let's do that. Cool, so with that transistor now moved out of the way, you'll notice that there is a little jumper link under where that transistor was, labeled 9247. We need to install a jumper wire there. All right, our jumper link is in. We need to install our 2.2 microfarad capacitor at C401. I'm just using a 2.2 microfarad 50 volt. It doesn't really matter on the voltage as long as it's over 16. And of course, make sure you get the polarity correct. It is marked on the seal screen on the board. And finally, we need to install our two resistors. So you need a 39K resistor at R403, which is this space here, and a 47K resistor at R402, which is this spot here. That should be it. I'll reassemble this and we'll give it a test. Before I go touching the anode cap, I'm just gonna discharge it one more time. Let's bring it over, see if we get a tiny little spark from it. Ooh, we did. That's cool. So yes, always, if you've removed the anode cap, always go back, discharge one more time before you go touching it to reconnect the anode cap. Right, our monitor is reassembled. The Super Nintendo is hooked back up by S-Video at the moment, just so we can test this out. So let's see if it still works. Oh, there we go. Still looks good. S-Video looks okay. Probably should test the audio. And I do not have, don't have audio because I don't have the rear cover with the speakers put on. Actually, while we've got this, I do need to pop out the old SCART blanking plate. Right, seems all the knives I have up here are all rubbish. Cool, we are ready. Perfect. Alright, S-Video still works. And we have audio. Stereo audio. Cool. That looks good. Let's swap over to SCART. And it looks incredibly sharp. All right, so just as an example, this is what the menu looks like with RGB enabled. And this is what it looks like through S-Video. Again, this is S-Video. And this is RGB. So now that the RGB SCART mod is complete and fully working, the only thing I want to do now is just align the yoke a little bit and also deal with a little bit of misconvergence here and there. So I'm going to pop the rear cover back off this thing and make some adjustments to the yoke. I may also have to spin the wheels of fortune, as Steve from Retro Tech would say. So I'm going to get to that. I don't plan on showing that process, at least not in this video, but I will put in some before and after shots at the end of the video. The reason for that is simply because working on a CRT when it's turned off is dangerous as it is. And working on one where you have to make these adjustments, it needs to be powered on, which is on another level. So I don't really plan on showing that, at least not in today's video. I might do a future video where we just focus on those kind of adjustments, but yeah, not today. So stick around, I'll put some before and after shots at the end. But as always, thank you for watching the Retro Channel. I hope you found this entertaining or interesting or something. A massive thanks to the people that support the channel on Patreon and YouTube memberships. And if you want to do the same, links are down below. You'll get ad-free, early access, all that kind of jazz. But yeah, until next time, thanks for watching the Retro Channel. Bye.